Come on, say it, everybody. God, my Savior.
God, my Savior.
God, my Savior.
God, my healer. God, my deliverer.
Yes, He is.
Yes, He is.
Yes, He is.
Yes, He is.
Be coming from Psalms 8. Psalms 8, and it reads as follows. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth, who have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have obtained strength because of your enemies, that you may silence the enemy and the avenger. When I consider your works of your fingers, the moon, the stars which you have ordained. What is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you visit him? For you have made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with glory and honor. You have made him to have dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, even the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, and the fish of the sea that pass through the path of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. May the Lord bless the reading of his word for the strength of our souls this morning. Amen.
Good morning, my Lilydale family. Let us pray. Our Father who art in heaven, holy is thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Father God, I thank you for waking us up this morning, clothing our right mind. I thank you for all that you do, for you are worthy to be praised. Father God, I come to you, I pray for our children. I pray that you put your protecting arms around them and cover them as they go to and fro throughout this city. I pray for our city, oh Lord. I pray for our country. I pray for our world. I pray for that you heal our land. You said if we pray to you, that you will hear our prayers and cleanse our land. I pray for that you stop these wars, rumors of wars. You said that this would happen, you know, and it's happening everywhere. You've done it before. I know you can do it again. Father God, I pray for the homeless. I pray for the sick and shut in. I pray for the caregivers. I pray that you cover them and protect them, oh Lord. I pray for those that have lost loved ones. I pray that you put your loving arms around them and cover them. I pray for my pastor, his family. I pray for my church family. I pray that somebody might hear his words and come down the aisle and ask what they must do to be saved. All these things I pray for in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Everybody clap your hands and bless the name of the Lord, for he is great. Has he done anything for anybody this week? If you don't mind, can you testify, talk to your neighbor, tell your neighbor one thing that the Lord has done for you this week?
He woke me up.
We give him glory for everything that he's done. He's a great God. We're going to sing this song that says, "The Great I Am provides for me." How many of you know he's still providing for you? He's still taking good care of you. Slip one hand in there and testify, be a witness. Hallelujah. I'm going to say, I have everything.
I have everything I need.
I have everything.
I have everything.
Testify.
I have everything I need.
Great I am.
The great I am.
Provides for me.
Provides for me.
The great I am.
The great I am.
Provides for
provides
me.
Provides for
you. Come on, lift your hands and say it one more time. I have everything.
I have everything I need.
Got a reasonable portion of health and strength.
I have everything I need.
I was able to turn the heat on when I wanted to. Come on, somebody.
I have everything I need.
That's the great I am. He still provides.
The great I am provides for me.
Come on, say it. The great I am.
The great I am
provides for me. Who he is, say, you are my strength.
You are my strength when I am weak.
Come on, church, I want you to sing it with us. You are my strength.
You are my strength when I am weak.
You are my strength when I am weak.
You are my strength when I am weak.
The great I am.
The great I am.
Provides the great I am.
The great I am.
I am.
That I am.
Can you open your mouth and give him glory? He's still making a way. He's still opening doors. Come on, somebody. He's still healing the sick. He's still raising the dead. His blood is still working. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, even now, even now, even now, in the midst of your problems, even now, he's working. It's working for your good. It's working for your good. It's working for your good. I know we're supposed to sing that hymn, but can we just lift our hands and worship him for a second? Oftentimes, we like to tip God with our praise when he does something for us. But we got to grow to a place where we can worship him just for his ability. You are able to do it, so I give you glory. Can you lift up holy hands and wave them in the air? Just because we serve an able God. He's able to provide for you. He's able to do it. Yay. Well, I declare and decree this day that it's working out for your good. Look at your neighbor and just go ahead and prophesy. And say, neighbor, it's working out for your good. Can you be bold in the spirit and find one more person and say, neighbor, it's working out for your good. I believe the promises of the Lord. His promises are yea and amen. I believe it's still coming. Every promise that he made is still on the way. How many of you believe it? Anybody expecting God to do what he said he's gonna do? Well, let's not wait till the battle is over. Can we open our mouths and shout right now, knowing that you got the victory? Hallelujah.
find one more person to prophesy and say, neighbor, it's already done. 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 In the name of Jesus. Maybe you got everything already worked out the way you want it to be, and your life is set up the way you expected. But if anybody's expecting a mighty move of God in your life, expect him to move to keep his promises, because he is a promise keeper. You ought to get excited thinking about what God has in store for you. Now listen, what I like about that is that don't apply to only 20-year-olds. It don't apply to only 40-somethings. It don't apply to only 60-somethings. But it applies to everybody. How many of you know you haven't even seen your greatest victory? You haven't even seen your greatest blessing. Somebody ought to open your mouth and shout right there. Let's all stand, let's all stand. I believe I'm in the right house with the right folks, with the right believers. And I'm gonna get what the Lord has promised for me. I expect it. And I'm going to activate. I'm going to get his attention with my praise. Lord, I hear you. And I want what you have for me. And I'm going to receive it in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We're going to sing, "Can't Nobody Do Me Like Jesus." If he's keeping you, come on, put your hands together. Come on right here, say it.
Can't nobody do me like Jesus. Can't nobody
do me like the Lord.
Do me like the Lord. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. He's my friend.
He picked me up.
Picked me up and turned me around. He's my friend.
Take it personal. Heal my body.
Heal my body.
Told me to run on.
Told me to run on. Heal my body.
And it told me.
Told me to run on.
Heal my body. And it told me to
told
run,
me run on. Yeah. He's my friend.
Hey, hey, hey. Can't nobody do me like Jesus.
Can't nobody do me like Jesus.
Nobody. Pick me up and turn me around.
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 Heal my body, told me to run on.
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 Nobody, nobody.
Nobody, nobody.
Nobody, nobody.
Today, thank God for another day that he has given us, that we might worship him in spirit and in truth. Amen. Aren't you glad that he allowed your golden moments to roll on one more day? Amen. Amen. I am happy to see you all this morning. Thank God for his many, many blessings upon us. Amen. I want to thank you all for praying for my dad this past week, as he had to undergo some surgery on Monday. I said that he was going to have some serious surgery, and I thought when you're 92, every surgery is serious surgery, and but he came through wonderfully. Amen. Matter of fact, the doctors were remarking that it was amazing that a 92-year-old man could have surgery like he had and be in ICU and go straight home. Amen. No hospital room and all that. Just send him on home right from there. And so I'm grateful to God. Don't stop praying. Amen. Because it's working. Amen, amen, amen. My dad tells a joke about an experience that he had as a deacon years ago at the church that he formerly was a member of, and he had a buddy there. I know Sister Coleman, there's a couple of folks who know that guy. I ain't gonna call his name, but he had a deacon friend, and he said, "Deacon, are you a praying man?" He said, "Yes, sir." He said, "Well, I'm going through some stuff, and I want you to pray for me." He said, "Well," he said, "love, I'll pray for you. I'll keep you in prayer." And about 2 weeks later, my daddy called him in the hall. He said, "Deacon, are you still praying?" He said, "Yeah, I'm still praying." He said, "Quit, because it got worse." But your prayer, the prayers of the righteous, availeth much. And so I thank God for each one of you. I am so happy to see you. I heard that they were at church a couple of weeks ago when I was out, but I look out and I see Sister Mary Hill and Sister Renetta. Amen. So happy to see you today. Thank God. And I am celebrating today with Deacon Quentin Milroe and Sister Paula Milroe. I watched the football game last night. At least half of it, maybe three quarters of it, I watched it. And the starting quarterback for the number one team in the country was named Milroe. Amen. The Alabama Crimson Tide has a sophomore quarterback who is running the show. And his name is Jalen Milroe, and he is the proud grandson of two proud grandparents, Deacon Quentin Milroe and Mr. Paula Milroe. And I teased him yesterday because he sent me a text and said, he said, "My grandson's going to be playing. He's starting today." He said, "Pray my strength in the Lord." And I sent the text back to him. I said, "Your strength?" I said, "He the one playing. What about his strength?" But after I started watching and cheering for him and getting nervous every time they came after him, I said, "I understand now, D. I'm praying your strength in the Lord." And he did a great job. I think they won, and they're undefeated this year. And he threw three touchdown passes and ran for a whole bunch of yards. Amen. So I'm going to keep my eye on this guy because he's the guy he replaced as the number one Heisman Trophy candidate. So I'm going to keep my eye on him. And listen, you can't miss Milroe. Amen. Amen. So congratulations, Deacon and Mrs. Milroe. Amen. Amen. I do want to ask you to pray for all of our sick and all of our shut-in. Sister Betty McIntosh had surgery a week ago, but had to go back to the hospital this week. And so we want to pray and ask God to bless her and strengthen her. And then we lost this week one of our ushers. anybody who's been in Lilydale more than two Sundays has had an encounter with Brother Huey Carroll. Amen. Amen. And we're going to miss him. We're going to have his services at the Heritage Campus on next Saturday, October 22nd. The wake will be at 11, and the funeral will be at noon. But let's keep Sister Constance Carroll, Sister Rudy Portia, Pooh Kemp Duncan in our prayers. Let's keep that entire family in our prayers. Amen. Amen. This morning, I want to go back to the same place that I ended up last week. I want to go back to John chapter 15. And I think last week we ended with verse 7. I had a preacher friend out of Los Angeles, California, Dr. R.A. Williams, who was asked once by a group of preachers that said, "Pastor, what do you do when you have exhausted the text, the verse that you were in?" And he simply said, "Go to the next verse." And so this morning I want to go to the next verse, John chapter 15, beginning with verse number 8. There you'll find these words: "Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciple. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full." Amen. Amen. Today, I want to talk for a few moments about the road to fullness. The road to fullness. There's a preacher friend of mine traveled with me to Africa a few years ago, who preached the sermon before the African Baptist Assembly in Malawi, that said to those who walked as much as 400 miles to get there, to hear the word of God. And he looked out at all that sea of black folks, and he had felt a kinship with those who were there, as if he had been taken away. We had spent the day before walking down the road that was the main slave passage from Blantyre, Malawi, to the Indian Ocean, where the slave ships were waiting. And he said to the congregation that day, he said, "I feel like I left this place empty, but I came back full." And I thought about that, and I said, isn't that really the way our lives are from day to day? That we get up full, trying to meet all of the challenges of the day, and that many times we just make it into the house, not just getting into the bed or crawling into the bed, but falling into the bed. Amen. As if we leave full and we get back empty. And that's the way a weekly cycle is for church members sometimes, is that we leave here on Sunday full, but we come back on Sunday morning empty. The old deacon used to pray all the time. He said, I come before you, Lord, as the empty pitcher in front of a full fountain. But I want you to know today that the God we serve can put you on the road to perpetual fullness. Amen. He can fill us up with his spirit and fill us up with his love and fill us up with his joy. And not only won't it run out, but David said, you anoint my head with oil and my cup, come on, help me preach this morning, runneth over. And so there is a desire from the master to show us how to live full lives. Can I just tell you today, before I really get into the text, that when I talk about full lives, I'm not talking about how much money is in your bank account. I'm not talking about how many cars are in your garage. Amen. Amen. Or even, as the Old Testament prophets used to say, how many arrows in your quiver, which really mean how many children you have that make you rich. No, I'm talking about the fullness of the Spirit that enables you to get through any challenge that life throws at us. I know you're probably still looking at me cross-eyed from a couple weeks ago when I said that we ought to really develop the kind of spirit where we face trouble with a smile. Amen. Amen. Oh, Lord, my bills are due. I ain't got no money. Ha, ha, ha. No, that ain't. You're not laughing, Sam, about all that. But there ought to be a. Already done. On the. It says, herein is my Father glorified. When I look at that, it reminds me that the Lord does something that he does not always do. And that is, he doesn't just tell us what he wants us to know, but he tells us the rationale behind what he told us. Amen. Amen. It's that old slave preacher stuff. You know, there's a story of a and nobody would ever say amen. But there was an itinerant slave preacher. Couldn't read, but everywhere he went, the folk would come from plantations around just to hear him preach. How is it that folk respond to your preaching and you're a slave? And they don't pay any attention to me, and I'm a master. And the slave said, put it this way. He said, well, let me tell you what I do. He said, first of all, I tells them what I'm gwine tell them. And then secondly, I tells them. And then after I tells them, I come back and then I tells them what I done told them. So Jesus does the same thing here. He says, I am the vine, you are the branches. My Father is the husbandman. And then he keeps coming back and he tells us
thing that you need to know is that you have to have a sense of for what you do. What Jesus really said is the purpose for me telling you all of this and giving you this information is so that our Father will be glorified. You ain't with me yet. It's not about you. It's not about me. It's not even about this church. But it's about God getting you full in your life. Then stop thinking about what you don't have and start thinking about what God has done and do what you can do for His glory. The purpose of fruit bearing is to glorify God. Amen. Amen. I'm going to say that again. The purpose of the fruit-bearing enterprise is to glorify God. I don't preach the gospel so that I could be celebrated as a known preacher. I want God to get the glory. Amen. Amen. And whatever we do, I don't care how great you sound when you sing. If you're singing so folk can call your name, then you're going to find yourself empty every now and then and wondering how to get the joy of the Lord back in your spirit. You've got to learn that your purpose is to give God glory. We were created to give God glory. The purpose of the coming of Christ to the world certainly was to redeem us